Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for our Bible study. Thank you because we always come together and your Spirit has always been with us, teaching us your word. We're praying that as we come together tonight, once again, teach every one of us in Jesus' name. We pray, Lord, you give us a right attitude to your word, that as we hear and you apply the word to our lives, we pray, oh Lord, the application of the word will do good in every life in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord, for the understanding that you have given us already. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Tonight, we're in Revelation chapter 22. I'm reading from verse 10. And we're studying the last part of the chapter, of the last chapter of Revelation tonight. Revelation chapter 22, verse 10. And it says unto me, seal not the sayings of the prophecy of this book, for the time is at hand. He that is unjust, let him be unjust still. And he that is filthy, let him be filthy still. And he that is righteous, let him be righteous still. And he that is holy, let him be holy still. Behold, I come quickly, and my reward is with me to give every man according to his work shall be. Blessed, I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. Blessed are they that do his commandments, that they may have right to the tree of life, and may enter in through the gates into the city. For without are dogs, and sorcerers, and all mongers, and murderers, and idolaters, and whosoever loveth and maketh a lie. I, Jesus, have sent mine angel to testify unto you these things in the churches. I am the root and the offspring of David, and the bright and morning star. And the spirit and the bride say, come. And let him that heareth say, come. And let him that is athirst, come. And whosoever will, let him take the water of life freely. For I testify unto every man that heareth the words of the prophecy of this book. If any man shall add unto these things, God shall add unto him the plagues that are written in this book. And if any man shall take away from the words of the book of this prophecy, God shall take away his part out of the book of life, and out of the holy city, and from the things which are written in this book. He which testifieth these things saith, surely I come quickly. Amen. Even so, come, Lord Jesus. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Amen. That's what we're looking at today, and it's the concluding passage or the concluding study in the revelation of Jesus Christ. It's the revelation of Jesus Christ. And as we have looked at the revelation from chapter 1, now to the last chapter, what a revelation this is. And the Lord Jesus Christ said, he is the one that sent his angel to testify all these things. Let's look at verse 16. I, Jesus, have sent mine angel to testify unto you these things in the churches. It's been talking about the glorified Christ, and also the message to the church, and then the glories of heaven in chapters 4 and 5, and then the great tribulation in chapter 6 to chapter 19, then the binding of the devil and thrown into the bottomless pit in chapter 20, and then you have the great white throne judgment, and now we come to chapter 21, which is the New Jerusalem, and chapter 22 continues the description of that New Jerusalem, the holy city, the heavenly city, which cometh down from the presence of God, even as a bride unto the bridegroom. And now we're looking at this last part, and the Lord is telling us all these things we have learned that the Lord has revealed unto us. He says, I, Jesus, your Lord and Master, I, Jesus, the Redeemer, I, Jesus, the coming King, have sent mine angel to testify and to reveal unto you these things in the churches. He wants all the people in the churches to understand this revelation. Now, when you look at just that verse alone, I, Jesus, had sent my angel, and I've sent my angel to testify unto you these things in the churches. As you look at verse 8 and verse 9, you remember we learnt about that last week, last Monday. In verse 8, it says, I, John, saw these things and heard them. And when I had heard and seen, I fell down to worship before the feet of the angel which showed me these things. Then saith he unto me, see thou do it not, for I am thy fellow servant, and of the brother of thy brethren, of the prophets, and of them that keep the sayings of this book, worship God. I want to point your attention to the fact that the angel said, I am thy fellow servant. And as we link that up with verse 16, I've sent my angel. It belongs to me. It's my servant. And I sent my angel to testify these things to you in the churches. And the angel said, John, you are a servant of God. I'm a servant of God. And he says, I am thy fellow servant and of thy brethren the prophets, revealing the truth of God unto the people of God. We cannot pass by that without noticing something. The angel was very, very faithful. Describing Christ, he was faithful. Sending the message to the various churches, he was very faithful. And then revealing the glories of heaven and the honor of God and the exaltation of the Lamb and the Lion of the tribe of Judah. He was very faithful in delivering the messages of glory and the message of exaltation. He was very faithful. And then when it comes to revealing the great tribulation, he was faithful as well. Positive messages that enlighten us and that gladden our hearts, he was faithful. And then revealing messages that will make us sad and make us unhappy and make us tremble because of the coming judgment at the time of the great tribulation, he was very, very faithful as well. We're learning something from that as their servant, the angel was very faithful in delivering the message, so are we to be in delivering the message that the Lord has given us, because we too were servants of the Lord. Revelation chapter 1 verse 1. In Revelation chapter 1 verse 1, the revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave unto him to show unto his servants the things which must shortly come to pass. And he sent and signified it by his angel unto his servant John. He sent and signified it by his angel. That angel actually belonged to the Lord. And he couldn't do just what he wanted. He had to do what the Lord wanted. And although the revelation was being given to John through the angel, the revelation was still of Jesus Christ. The revelation of Jesus Christ. Then it says, which God gave unto him. And as you think about the message we are preaching, how do you think about the message of salvation? It's the revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave unto him. How do you think about the revelation of the judgment of God upon the sinners? It's the revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave unto him. How do you think about all the other messages on holiness, on restitution, on righteousness, one man, one wife? Any message we're preaching from the Bible is the revelation of Jesus Christ, and which God gave unto him. Now he is revealing that to us, and we are to be faithful as servants of God, as that angel was faithful in revealing everything unto John. And John now wrote everything down without subtracting, without adding. Can I just show you that everyone that is serving the Lord, we are referred to as the servants of the Lord. And as the servants of the Lord, we're to be as faithful as that angel delivering the message without subtraction, without addition. In Romans chapter 1, I'm reading from verse 1. Here Paul the apostle talks about himself. And who is he? Paul, a servant of Jesus Christ. Paul, a servant of Jesus Christ. Was that angel a servant of Jesus? Yes. How about Paul the apostle? A servant of Jesus Christ. In Philippians chapter 1, I'm reading from verse 1. Philippians chapter 1, we're looking at verse 1. Here we meet other servants, Paul and Timotheus, the servants of Jesus Christ. A younger minister. Who are we? We're still servants of Jesus Christ. Paul and Timotheus, the servants of Jesus Christ. And the revelation that God gives us, the message that God gives us, it may be tough, it may be hard, it may be simple, it may be loving, it may be talking about the glory of God and the provision of God and the promises of God, or it may be talking about the judgment of God. We are to be as faithful as that angel, revealing everything to the people he has sent us to. In 2 Peter chapter 1, I'm reading from verse 1. Second Peter chapter 1 verse 1. Simon Peter, a servant and an apostle of Jesus Christ. Simon Peter, a servant of Jesus Christ. Do you see how everyone, they recognize the fact that they belong to the Lord. And they were not just to preach whatever they wanted to preach or say whatever they wanted to say. And if God reveals a message to you, like Revelation chapter 1, talking about the exaltation of Christ and talking about the glory of Christ, tell it to the people. And if he tells you messages for the church of Ephesus or Smyrna or his Pergamos or his Thyatira or his Smyrna or his Philadelphia, or he's telling you about the sleeping lukewarm church, Laodicea, whatever message he has given, give it as he has given it. And then if he's revealing the glories of heaven, of the land of the tribe of Judah, of the Lamb of God that takes the rule from the hand of the Almighty God and is able to break the seal, is able to open it, reveal it to the people just like that. And when he tells you to talk about the day of his wrath has come and who shall be able to abide because of the fierce indignation of the Lord, don't shy away from that and don't shrink back from that. Reveal it as he has given you. Have you seen the glory of the New Jerusalem? And then it's coming down from above and it's revealed to you. See the bride of Christ and see the saints of God marching in. Reveal it as he has given it to you. That's what we're learning here. All these apostles, all these teachers, all these pastors, they knew themselves as the servants of the Lord. And they revealed the message exactly as he had given unto them. And look at Jude verse 1. In Jude verse 1, here is what we're told. In Jude, the servant of Jesus Christ. Jude, the servant of Jesus Christ. Is there any overseer there listening to me? Is there any pastor there studying with us here tonight? And is there any coordinator there, any preacher there, any woman leader there, any house fellowship leader there? We're servants of God and servants of Christ. And we do not take away from the message. When it is sweet, give it out. And when it is the bitter pill of the warning of coming judgment, give it out. In Colossians chapter 4, I'm reading verse 12. Colossians chapter 4. Reading from verse 12, every preacher is referred to as servant of Christ. Every leader is referred to as a servant of Christ. And we're not in the ministry to preach whatever we want to preach or to do our own will. We come into the ministry to do the will of the one who is our master. In Colossians chapter 4, reading from verse 12, Epaphras, who is one of you, a servant of Christ. A servant of Christ. And now talking about everybody that knows the Lord. It talks about us in Ephesians chapter 6. We're looking at verse 6. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 6. Not with eye service as men pleasers, but as the servants of Christ, doing the will of God from the heart. When you think about this angel that the Lord Jesus Christ sent, I, Jesus, I've sent my angel to testify unto you these things in the churches. What could the angel do more than this? Servant of Christ, doing the will of God from the heart. As you think about Paul the apostle, as you think about Timothy, as you think about Peter, and as you think about Jude, as you think about Epaphras, as you think about Moses, Joshua, the rest of them, as you think about the servants of God in Bible days, what else could they do? Servants of Christ, doing the will of God from the heart. As you think about preachers today, and you think about yourself, a Christian, a believer, and you belong to Christ, what more can you do? Here should be the description of your life as servants of Christ, doing the will of God from the heart. And that's the reason why the Lord is bringing us together, studying the Bible every time, that every time you approach the word of God, you say, Lord, help me. Every time you have chance to preach, Lord, help me. I'm standing here as servant of Christ, doing the will of God from the heart. And everything you reveal to me, to reveal to the people of God, help me, neither by fear nor by intimidation, to detract anything, to diminish anything, to subtract anything, but to give everything out so that you'll be like the servants of God in Bible days, and the commendation that they had, you'll be able to have also. I pray that God will help us with his grace in Jesus' name. A good amen. Amen. I divide the message to three parts. The message is the imminent return of Christ. imminent return of Christ. If you look at the latter part of verse 10, that's Revelation chapter 22, latter part of verse 10, for the time is at hand. And if you look at verse 12, behold, I come quickly. And verse 20, he that testified these things saith, surely I come quickly. That's why we titled the message, the imminent return, the soon return, the sudden return of Christ. The message is divided to three parts. Number one, proclamation of Christ's second coming. Number two, preparation for Christ's second coming. And then number three, preservation of the complete scriptural canon. The preservation of the complete scriptural canon. We come back to number one, the proclamation of Christ's second coming. Let's look at verse 10. In verse 10 it says, He says unto me, seal not the sayings of the prophecy of this book, for the time is at hand. What's the meaning of this? Seal not the writing or the saying or the utterance or the revelation of this prophecy, the prophecy of this book, because the time is at hand. The time is very near. Actually, the apostle was instructed not to close the book, not to seal the book, but to leave it open to the understanding of the church. Why? Because the time of its fulfillment is very near. In the case of Daniel, when Daniel had his own vision, Daniel was told the time is still far ahead. And because the time is still far ahead, close it up, seal it up. The people cannot understand it now because the time is still far ahead. In Daniel chapter 8, verse 26, Daniel chapter 8, verse 26, and the vision of the evening and the morning, which was told, is true. Wherefore shut thou up the vision, seal it up, close it up. And don't, people will not understand now. Wherefore shut thou up the vision. Why? For it shall be for many days. The time is not yet. But in the case of Revelation, because I come quickly, and because the time is at hand, the time of its fulfillment is very near. Therefore, keep it open. Let the church read it. Let the church study it. Let the church understand it. Give them the key to understand it, so that they will be able to see from the warnings and from the promises that the coming of the Lord is very near at hand. In Daniel chapter 10, verse 14. Daniel chapter 10, verse 14. Now, I am come to make thee understand what shall befall thy people in the latter days, for yet the vision is for many days. Daniel was being told every time, the time is still far away. Daniel, it will not happen in your own lifetime. It will not happen for many years to come. But in the case of the book of Revelation, the time is at hand. Therefore, John, don't seal it up, don't close it up, don't shut it up, open it and reveal it to the people so that they will understand and get prepared. In Daniel chapter 12, I'm reading from verse 9 and verse 10. Daniel chapter 12, verse 9. And he said, go thy way, Daniel, for the words are closed up and sealed till the time of the end. Many shall be purified and made white and tried, but the wicked shall do wickedly, and none of the wicked shall understand, but the wise shall understand. The wicked shall not understand. It's written in such a way that the people who are wicked, the people who do not belong to the Lord, they will not understand the revelation. But as the time draws very near, God's persecuted people will draw much comfort from the prophecies of Christ's second coming. The prophecies also serve as warning, and they call us to change and transformation while there is still time, while it is still possible. After death and after judgment, the eternal state will be fixed forever and will be unchangeable. Do you see that in Revelation chapter 22? Revelation chapter 22, verse 11. He that is unjust, let him be unjust still. He which is filthy, let him be filthy still. He that is righteous, let him be righteous still. He that is holy, let him be holy still. It's telling us that after death has come, that the final end, there is no repentance in the grave. If you're going to repent today, that's the time of repentance. That's the opportunity for you to repent. After somebody has died, there is no repentance. It's a kind of unscriptural prayer, and foolish prayer, unlearned prayer. When somebody has died, and then they say, may his soul rest in peace, it's too late. If he's going to have the peace of God, if he's going to reconcile with God, it's before he dies. And then they get to the grave, and then they are praying, and they say, this person that has died now, whatever sin he has committed, whatever wrong he has done, oh Lord, may you forgive him in your mercy, and may you accept him into your paradise. It's too late, because where the tree falls, that's where the tree will remain. Ecclesiastes chapter 11 verse 3. Ecclesiastes chapter 11 verse 3. If the clouds be full of rain, they empty themselves upon the earth. And if the tree fall toward the south or toward the north, in the place where the tree falls, there it shall remain. He's talking about the human beings there, and he's using the picture of a tree. That is, before you died, if you were righteous, then you are righteous, and then you go to heaven. And if you were filthy or you're unjust, you remain filthy, and then you go to hell. Because where the tree falleth, there it will remain, there it will lie. And then we come back to Revelation. In this book of Revelation, we're looking at chapter 22, verse 12. It's talking about the coming of the Lord. And behold, I come quickly, and my reward is with me to give every man according as his work shall be. It says, behold, I come quickly. That's the Lord Jesus Christ making the announcement, the proclamation. I'm coming again, and my coming is very, very soon, and my coming will be very, very sudden. And let's look at 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 7. All the apostles of Christ, they remind us, and they teach us, they proclaim to us that the coming of the Lord is much, much at hand. In 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 7. But the end of all things is at hand. The end of all things is at hand, telling us that the world will come to an end and Christ will come. Be ye therefore sober and watch unto prayer. Be ye therefore sober and watch unto prayer. It tells us in Revelation chapter 1 verse 3, still telling us that the coming of the Lord, that time is very, very near. Revelation chapter 1 verse 3, blessed is he that readeth, and they that hear the words of the prophecy, of this prophecy, and keep those things which are written therein, for the time is at hand. The time is at hand. Is coming again. Revelation chapter 1 verse 7. Revelation 1 7. Behold, he cometh with the clouds, and every eye shall see him, and they also which pierced him, and all kindreds of the earth shall wail because of him. Even so, amen. That means, even so, let it be. The Lord is coming. And then at the end of this Revelation, this is chapter 22 verse 20. Revelation chapter 22 verse 20. It tells us in the beginning of the Revelation chapter 1. And it tells us at the end of the book of Revelation chapter 22. It says, he would testify these things, saith, surely I come quickly. Amen. Even so, come Lord Jesus. If you are a real student of the Bible and you read the Bible very well, there will be no doubt in your heart, Jesus is coming again. We're told in James chapter 5. James chapter 5, reading there from verse 8. Is very much close at the door. It's very near his coming. In James chapter 5 verse 8, be ye also patient, establish your hearts, for the coming of the Lord draweth near. The coming of the Lord draweth near. The Lord is coming. And as we know that the Lord is coming, we ought to have the right attitude. In fact, we ought to be very much prepared. When he says, I come quickly, these are the unalterable words of Christ, our Savior and our Redeemer, who is faithful and true. He tells us himself, heaven and earth shall pass away, but my word shall never pass away unfulfilled. Certainly and assuredly, suddenly and very soon, Christ will come. Then each man that ever lived on earth will receive his just reward and recompense, or either will receive a crown or will receive a curse. either heaven or hell, either reward or recompense. The rewards of the righteous will be in heaven, and then that recompense of the sinners will be in hellfire. But the rewards of the people of God will vary according to their works. What is your attitude? How do you prepare as you see that the Lord is coming? Let's look at Romans chapter 13, verse 12. Romans chapter 13, verse 12. The night is fast spent. The night is at hand. The day is at hand. Let us therefore cast off the works of darkness, and let us put on the armor of light. It says, the time is very near. The Lord is coming. And as a result that the Lord is coming, then cast off the works of darkness. What are those things? It tells us in verse 13, let us walk honestly as in the day, not in rioting and drunkenness, not in chambering or wantonness, not in strife and envying, but put ye on the Lord Jesus Christ, and make not provision for the flesh to fulfill the lusts thereof. You cannot just say about the coming of the Lord and not make some preparation. You have to be prepared. And as you cast off the work of darkness, and then you hold on to your own way and say, the Lord has sanctified me, purified me, made me righteous. I'm going to remain holy and pure and righteous and purged in the sight of the Lord. You'll be going on and on. In the goodness of the Lord, you'll not allow anything whatever to hinder that purity the Lord has given you. We're told in Job chapter 17. Verse 9. Job chapter 17, looking at it in verse 9. You are a righteous person, keep on being righteous, and you are holy, keep on being holy, and you love the Lord, you are cleaving to the Lord, keep on in cleaving to the Lord. In Job chapter 17 verse 9, the righteous also shall hold on his way. Temptations will come, hold on your way, and then the storms will come, and the winds will blow, but you hold on to your conviction, and you hold on to the Christ-like living, and the Christ-like behavior that the Lord himself has produced in you. The righteous also shall hold on his way, and he that has clean hands shall be stronger and stronger. And that's what a child of God ought to be. In fact, as you see the coming of the Lord drawing nearer and nearer, what else can you do but just say, Lord, I'm holding on, and I'm not going to allow anything whatsoever to hinder me in my preparation for the Lord, for the coming of the Lord. Let's come back to the book of Revelation chapter 22. In Revelation chapter 22, reading there from verse 12 again, the second part of verse 12, from the first part, behold, I come quickly, my reward is with me. It says, I am coming, and when I come, I'll not be coming empty-handed. Are there people that are winning souls? My reward is with me. Are there people that are restoring the backsliders? My reward is with me. I will reward them. Are there people that are encouraging other people to be righteous, to be holy? Are there people that are encouraging those who are weak and those who are sick and those who are wanting to give up the faith? And you're saying, hold on. Keep on to the Lord. Don't allow anything to draw you back. My reward is with me, and I will give every man according as his work shall be. What work are you doing in the church? How faithful are you? The Lord is looking at the way you are doing the work, and the Lord is looking at the glory of God that you are defending every time, and he's looking at the fact that you are making the sinners to turn away from their sin, and making the weak people to be strong, and praying for the people that cannot pray for themselves. And he says, I'm watching, and I'm soon coming, and I'm going to reward everyone according as his work shall be. And then he announces to us, he says, I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. When he said, I am Alpha and Omega, the first and the last, the beginning and the end, actually, four times in the book of Revelation, we read those words, I am Alpha and Omega. Turn your Bible to Revelation chapter 1. In Revelation chapter 1, you will see Jesus Christ, the glorified Christ, the exalted Christ, and the one that is coming to reign, how he made the announcement to John the beloved, I am Alpha and Omega. Revelation chapter 1 verse 8, I am Alpha and Omega,
the beginning and the ending, says the Lord, which is and which was and which is to come, the Almighty. And then he tells us in verse 11, saying the same thing, saying, I am Alpha and Omega, the first and the last. What thou seest, write in a book, and send it unto the seven churches which are in Asia, unto Ephesus, and unto Smyrna, and unto Pergamos, and unto Thyatira, and unto Sardis, and unto Philadelphia, and unto Laodicea, saying that he is Alpha and Omega. As we come to the end of the book, chapter 21, verse 6, and he says, unto me it is done. I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. I will give unto him that is athirst of the fountain of the water of life freely. And then you come to this verse we have read already, which is Revelation chapter 22, verse 13. I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. How do you understand that? Christ is the Omega, is the Alpha and the Omega. Alpha is the first letter of the Greek alphabet, and Omega is the last letter of the Greek alphabet. That means Christ is the beginning, and Christ is the ending of the all-inclusive revelation of God. Is the Lord of time, is the Lord of history, and is the Lord of eternity. When he says, I am Alpha and Omega, I'm the beginning and the end, I am the first and the last, is the Lord of time, and is the Lord of history, and is the Lord of eternity. The expression Alpha and Omega affirms Christ's deity. That means is God himself. All the qualities of God, all the attributes of God, all the perfections of Almighty God are also in Christ our Lord and Savior. He is the complete and the full manifestation of God in the flesh. He is also the Alpha and the Omega of the Holy Scriptures, from Genesis to Revelation, from the first to the last, from the beginning to the end. You find Christ there. Go into the book of Genesis, Christ is there. And go to Exodus, Christ is there. And when you open Leviticus, you find Christ there. As you look at Numbers and you see that brazen serpent lifted up, you see Christ there. And as you see the Deuteronomy and you see the one that is a prophet to come, I'll put my word in his mouth, he is there. You look at Joshua, he is there, the captain of our salvation. Look at Judges, the great judge, he is there. Everywhere you look in the book of God, in the Old Testament, Christ is there. And you open the New Testament, Matthew, it's the book of the generation of Jesus Christ. And then you go to the epistles, Christ is there in every page. You come to Revelation, it's there. It's the first and the last, the beginning and the end, the Alpha and the Omega of the Holy Scriptures, of the full revelation of God to man. Is the Alpha and the Omega of the entire Bible. Is the Alpha and the Omega of our salvation. The plan of our salvation is the beginning and the end, and the giving of the salvation is the beginning and the end, and keeping us in that salvation is the beginning and the end, and giving us the full salvation, the free salvation, the final salvation is the beginning and the end. Is the author and the finisher of our faith. He is the only Savior, and he saves to the uttermost, and he also is the root and the offspring of David. The root and the offspring of David. What does that mean? Well, when you look at a tree, what comes first? Is it the root or the trunk? Of course, it's the root. Therefore, the tree grows from its root. The root is first. Afterward, you have the sprout and the trunk. When it says, I am the root of David, what does that mean? That means I came before David. That because I'm the root of David, I existed before him. He existed from all eternity. The offspring of David. What does that mean? That means the son of David. And that's what confused the Pharisees. The Pharisees were asking a question about Jesus Christ. By what authority are you doing it? By what authority are you doing it? Who gave you this authority? I'll ask you one question. If this David called him Lord, if David called Jesus Christ Lord, then how is he the son? At the same time, they were dumbfounded. They couldn't answer. It's both the root and the offspring at the same time. It's both the Lord of David and the Son of David at the same time. In his divinity, that is, in his deity, is the Lord of David. But in his humanity, is the very Son of David. He existed before David and before all things. He is divine and he is God. That's why he tells us over here, as we come back to Revelation chapter 22, reading from verse 13, I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. Is God himself, is deity himself, is divine himself. All the attributes of deity of the Almighty God are also found in him. I come to point number two, the preparation for Christ's second coming. Preparation for Christ's second coming. In Revelation chapter 22 verse 14, all through to verse 17, blessed are they that do his commandments, that they may have right to the tree of life, and may enter in through the gates into the city. For without are dogs, and sorcerers, and all mongers, and murderers, and idolaters, and whosoever loveth and maketh a lie. I, Jesus, have sent mine angel unto these things, and to testify these things in the churches. I am the root and the offspring of David, the bright and the morning star. And the spirit and the bride say, come. And let him that heareth say, come. And let him that is athirst come. And whosoever will, let him take the water of life freely. It tells us in that verse 14, it says, blessed are they that do his commandments, that they may have right, that they may have the privilege to the tree of life, and that they may enter in through the gates into the city. As we think of the blessings that we receive many blessings from the Lord. The blessing of salvation, the blessing of healing, the blessing of provision, the blessing of getting married, the blessing of having children, the blessing of getting a job, and the blessing of having our enemies submit to us, and the blessing of eventually getting to heaven. But the greatest of all these blessings is the blessing of entering heaven. The blessing of spending eternity, an eternity of unspeakable joy, uninterrupted happiness with God in heaven throughout all eternity, and the right or the privilege to partake of the tree of life freely and fully, a privilege which our first parents lost and never regained on earth. A great blessing indeed. The question is, how will this long awaited blessing be yours, be mine, be ours? It tells us in that verse 14, blessed are they that do his commandments. Blessed are they that do his commandments. There's a difference between knowing the commandments and doing the commandments. There's a difference between memorizing the commandments and doing the commandments. There's a difference between teaching the commandments and doing the commandments. It's not the people that read. It's not the people that know. It's not the people that hear. It's not the people that preach it. It's not the people that teach it. The people that do it. And as you ask yourself, of course, you know a lot of the commandments of God. If I were to ask the average member of this church or the average person listening to me in this study, do you know the commandments of God? And you say, which one? The one relating to murder, thou shalt not kill. How about the one relating to adultery? Thou shalt not commit adultery. How about the one relating to false witness? Thou shalt not bear false witness. How about the one relating to respecting, honoring your father and your mother? Thou will honor your father and your mother, that your days may be long on the earth that the Lord has given you. We know it. We know it. But blessed are they that do his commandments, that they may have right to the tree of life and may enter in through the gates into the city. You see, the blessedness is for the people that do the commandments of the Lord. Now turn your Bible to Psalm 119, the blessedness of the people of God. And here is a part of blessing in Psalm 119 verses 1 and 2. Psalm 119 verses 1 and 2. Blessed are the undefiled in the way, who walk in the law of the Lord. What's that saying? Very simple. Blessed are those that do his commandments. You know the commandments, and you are walking in the path of righteousness. In those commandments, in verse 2, blessed are they that keep his testimonies and that seek him with the whole heart. You are not absent-minded, and you are not serving the Lord haphazardly. With all your heart, with all your soul, you concentrate, and you are really serving the Lord. Blessed are they that do the commandment of the Lord, and they keep his way, and they keep his statutes with their whole heart. Then it tells us in Proverbs chapter 8, verse 32. Proverbs chapter 8, reading from verse 32. The people that are blessed, and the people that are going to have this great, the greatest of all blessings. In Proverbs chapter 8, verse 32. Now therefore, hearken unto me, O ye children, for blessed are they that keep my ways. Blessed are they that keep my ways. The word keep there is to obey. That you are being the word of the Lord, the will of the Lord, the ways of the Lord. You are following the word of God. You are not following your own selfish way. You are not following the way of society. You are not following the way of Satan. You are following the way of the Lord. In Luke chapter 11 verse 28. Luke chapter 11. Reading from verse 28. Hear the word of the Lord says, and he said unto him, in chapter 11, verse 28. Luke chapter 11, verse 28. But he said, ye rather blessed are they that hear the word of God and keep it. Blessed are they that hear the word of God and keep it. That's the blessedness. You see, when the Lord convicts you of sin, of something wrong in your life, and then you fall on your knees, or you stand up, and with all your heart, you send a burning heart, a message from a burning heart unto God. Oh Lord, I'm sorry. I'm repenting of my sin. I will not do that again. I'm sorry I went astray. I'm sorry I did evil. The Lord said, you are blessed because you have had the word of God about repentance, and you are repenting right there. And when you hear that you ought to be humble and submissive to the word of God and to the leadership of the church, the people who are teaching the word of God, then you examine your life. Oh Lord, how sorry I am. I've been rebellious. I've been disobedient. I've gone my own way. I repent in dust and ashes. I will never do that again. That's the blessed. You become blessed because you hear the word of God and do it. Or maybe you are owing somebody a particular amount of money, and then you hear the word of it strikes you. I'm a debtor. Suppose the Lord shall come now and I don't have the money. Oh Lord, I'm going to do my best. And you go to that person that very night or the second day. You know, I remember I'm owing you. I was at the Bible study yesterday and I had the word of God. It struck me anew as if I'm the debtiest person in that Bible study. My brother, please forgive me. I'm going to pay you. Even though you don't have the money yet, the blessedness is that you tremble at the word of God. The blessedness is that you are willing to be obedient to the word of God. But you know, there are other people that come to the Bible study, and it's like they're not coming to the Bible study. At the end of the Bible study, there's no change of attitude. There's no change of conduct. There's no change of character. And there's no change of their disposition from within. They just jest with the word of God. They laugh at the word of God. And then we finish the Bible study. Even at the time that the other people are seriously praying. And they say, oh Lord, touch my heart. Oh Lord, change my heart. Oh Lord, cut off this sin away from my life. Oh Lord, this carelessness and this jesting and all that. Cut it away from my life. As the other people are praying with seriousness, some of them even weeping with tears in their eyes. This fellow will just be, you know, playing and making fun of everything. Although it's at the Bible study every time, he's hearing but he's not doing it. But the blessedness is for the people that hear the word of God and do that word of God. And that's why we're here today, so that once again, as you are hearing the word of God, then the Lord himself by his spirit will bring conviction upon your heart, and you'll be among the blessed people in Jesus' name. In Revelation chapter 16, I'm reading from verse 15. Revelation chapter 16, the people who are blessed, the people who are blessed. Revelation chapter 16, reading from verse 15. Behold, I come as a thief. Blessed, this is it again, that's the word blessed. Blessed is he that watcheth and keepeth his garments. Blessed is he that watcheth and keepeth his garment, lest they walk naked and they see his shame. In Revelation chapter 22 and in verse 7. Revelation 22, reading from verse 7. Behold, I come quickly. Blessed is he that keepeth the sayings of the prophecy of this book. Do you see in all the blessedness that we have read, it doesn't promise any blessedness to the people who are careless, to the people who are sinful, to the people who are backsliding, to people who are nonchalant, to the people who do not care for the word of God, to the people who do not submit under the mighty hand of the Almighty God, and who do not submit to the word of God. It's only the saved and the separated and the sanctified and the pure, the purified, that have the blessings of God upon their lives. And where are you? Where do you stand? On what side are you? In Matthew chapter 5, reading there from verse 8. Matthew chapter 5, reading from verse 8. The people who will be blessed to see the Lord eventually, blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. As we look at the word of God, then the word of God tells us who are the blessed people and who are the people that will be able to see the Lord on that final day. This desired eternal blessedness will not be granted or given to the immoral, to the sorcerers, to the idolaters, and to the adulterers, and to the murderers, and to the liars, because they have not been cleansed and purged from their sin. Look at Revelation chapter 22, verse 15. Revelation 22, verse 15. For without are the dogs, and the sorcerers, and the whoremongers, and the murderers, and idolaters, and whosoever, loveth and maketh a lie. You see the reason why people tell lies, why they manufacture lies, why they create lies, why they make lies, is because they are afraid to bear the consequence of what they have done. It's happened, it's happened. If you have done something wrong, just go to the Lord and say, Lord, I'm sorry. And the Lord will forgive you. And once the Lord has forgiven you, you're on your way to heaven. If anybody asks you, just come out plain. Yes, I'm sorry. I've repented of it, but I did it. I was wrong. But thank God, I'm okay now. I'm all right now. The blood of Jesus Christ has cleansed me now. You don't have to tell a lie. Even if somebody has to, you know, look down on you and belittle you and despise you and even punish you, even discipline you, doesn't matter at all. The very fact that your sins are forgiven, and the very fact that you're on your way to heaven, and the very fact that if Jesus came today, you'll be going to heaven, it will not matter whatever people think or say about you. There's no need to tell lies. What are we telling lies for? They are not the final judge. They are not the judge in heaven. They are just a, you know, human judge. You see, and I tell them the truth. And after telling the truth, stand and bear the consequence and don't worry about it at all. And then you live a life. You don't have to be covering up anything at all. And if you desire this heaven and this blessedness, you must come out clean and say, oh Lord, I want to be clean. I want to be holy. I want to be a real child of God. I don't want any blemish in my life at all. Let's look at 1 John chapter 2 verse 28. 1 John chapter 2. Looking at verse 28. And now little children, abide in him. Abide in him. When he shall appear, ye may have confidence and not be ashamed before him at his coming. If ye know that he is righteous, ye know that everyone that doeth righteousness is born of him. Those are the people that are going to get to heaven. They do righteousness. Not just that they know the doctrine of righteousness. Not just that they are preaching the doctrine of righteousness. Not just that they are sharing the message of righteousness with other people in the house fellowship, or in the zone, or in the district, or in the area, or in any place, or in the province, or anywhere. Not just that you know it, but you are doing righteousness. Then that shows that you are born of God and you abide in him. You will not allow anything to contaminate you, to destroy the confidence you have in the Lord and the righteousness you have in the Lord and the covenant you have made with the Lord. You have promised the Lord, Lord, if you save me, I'm not going to continue in my sins. Then stay by that covenant. In 1 John chapter 3 verse 1, behold, what manner of love the Father has bestowed upon us that we should be called the sons of God. Therefore the world knoweth us not, because it knew him not. Beloved, now are we the sons of God, and it does not yet appear what we shall be, but we know that when it shall appear, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. Just the joy of that. And the expectation of that, that you're expecting when the Lord will come, you will see him as he is. Then in verse 3, every man that has this hope in him purifieth himself even as he is pure. Everyone, if you have that hope in yourself, if that's your goal, if that's your ambition, if you don't just want to come to Bible study in vain, if you're not coming to Bible study just like attending a club, if you're not coming to church just like a society, if you're not just coming because daddy is coming, mommy is coming, if you're not coming just because friends are coming, if you're not coming just because, well, there's nowhere to go tonight, let me go to that their Bible study. If that's not your purpose, if you're serious minded, you have a goal, you have a purpose that you want to get to heaven on that final day, and every man that has this hope in him purifies himself even as he is pure. Psalm 119, I'm reading from verse 1 again. Psalm 119, I'm reading from verse 1. It tells us, blessed are the undefiled in the way, who walk in the law of the Lord. Blessed are they that keep his testimonies and that seek him with the whole heart. They also do no iniquity. They walk in his ways. Those are the people going to heaven. They do no iniquity, whether privately or publicly, whether when they're alone or when other people are with them, under closed doors or under with the open door, behind the curtain or outside the curtain, in their own houses or away from their houses. These are the people who are serious minded, who are heavenly minded, who know that the goal of life is that we're under probation here. And this is for preparation to go to heaven. The reason why we're still left on earth is so that we'll be able to serve the Lord and work for God and do things that will qualify us eventually to get to heaven, believing on the Lord and then following through on the results of faith and the fruit of faith in your life. They also do no iniquity. They walk in his ways. Thou has commanded us to keep thy precepts diligently. Oh, that my ways were directed to keep thy statutes. Then shall I not be ashamed when I have respect unto all thy commandments. You are not partial in the commandment of the Lord. You have respect, you have honor for all the commandments of the Lord. In Luke chapter 12. Luke chapter 12, reading from verse 37 and verse 38. Luke chapter 12, verse 37. Blessed are those servants whom the Lord, when he cometh, shall find watching. We're not to be careless anytime. We're not to stop watching every time. There's a devil that is vigilant. There's a devil that is going up and down to and fro, wanting to see whom he may devour, whom he may destroy. Therefore, we're to be watching every time. And blessed are those servants whom the Lord, when he cometh, shall find watching. Verily I say unto you, that he shall gird himself and make them sit down to meat, and will come forth and serve them. And if he shall come in the second watch, or come in the third watch, and find them so, blessed are those servants. If you are watching every time, and you'll not allow anything to touch your redemption, your salvation, your Christian life, and your commitment to the Lord. In 1 John, reading from chapter 2, verse 3. And hereby do we know that we know him, if we keep his commandments. Hereby do we know we're children of God, if we keep his commandments. Hereby do we know that we belong to the saints of God, to the assembly of the people of God, if we keep his commandments. Hereby do we know that we're getting ready for the rapture, and we're waiting for the coming of our Lord, if we keep his commandments. In verse 4, he that saith, I know him, and keepeth not his commandment, is a liar, and the truth is not in him. I'm born again, and is not keeping the commandment of God, is a liar. I'm a child of God, and is not keeping the commandments of God, is a liar. I'm even one of their workers, one of their leaders, and is not keeping the commandments of God, is a liar. He doesn't have the right heart, a changed heart, a transformed heart, and he doesn't have the correct attitude and the correct behavior. And he says, I'm a child of God, I'm born again, I'm one of you people. That's a lie. He that says, I know him, and keepeth not his commandments, is a liar. And the truth is not in him, but whoso keepeth his word. In him verily is the love of God perfected. Hereby know we that we are in him. And those are the people that will meet him when he comes. We'll see him when he comes. We shall see him, and then we shall be like him as he is. Revelation chapter 2 verse 7. Revelation chapter 2 verse 7. He that has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. As you come regularly to the Bible study, you have ears to hear. He that has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. And you see, it says the same thing to all the churches. Whether the church is at the capital here, or the church is, or the church is over there with you where you're listening to me now. Our church is in the village. And therefore, because our church is in the village, we're not going to receive the same message. Our church is in the interior. Therefore, we don't need to follow the same sanctification and holiness. Our church is, in a corner somewhere. But it's the same message and the same qualification to get to heaven. And whoever you are, and wherever you are worshiping, here is what the Spirit is saying to all the churches: to him that overcometh, I will give to eat of the tree of life, which is in the midst of the paradise of God. Those are the people that will have right to eat of that tree. You know, if you come back to Revelation chapter 22 verse 15, you know what it says? I'm sure you remember. Without outside are the dogs and the sorcerers and the whoremongers and the murderers and the idolaters and whosoever loveth and maketh a lie. Revelation chapter 21 verse 8. Revelation chapter 21, reading from verse 8. But the fearful and unbelieving and abominable and murderers and all mongers and sorcerers and idolaters and all liars. All liars. You know the people that give excuse. I only told lie to my daddy. It's my daddy now. I can tell him anything. All liars. I only told lie to my wife. She's my wife. And I can talk to her the way I can talk to her. I only told lie to my wife, but that's all liars. I only told lie to my husband, all liars. I only told lie to my children, they are my children. Daddy, daddy, as you are going, please buy this for me, buy this for me. Don't worry, I will go with you. And the child starts crying. And while the child is crying, you just want to silence the child. And you say you are a Christian. My boy, don't worry, I'm going out. When I come, I'll buy this for you. You hear? Okay, daddy, goodbye. I'm waiting for you. And then the child will stop crying. Then you come back. After you come back, the child is waiting at the door. Daddy, where is the thing you said you'll buy for me? My boy, you know, as I wanted to go and buy it like this, then one car blocked another place like this. And when it blocked, I wanted to go another way. And the ghost law was so much, my boy, I'll buy it tomorrow. You know you told a lie. You know you told a lie. Telling lie to your children is part of it. All liars. Why would a Christian tell lie to his own children? Why would a Christian tell lie to our own husband? Why would a Christian tell lie to his own wife? All liars shall have their part in the lake that burneth with fire and brimstone. We go back to correct those lies. My boy, although you are a teenager, I told you a lie. Although you are sin, primarily, I told you a lie. I've heard the word of God. I'm correcting my ways. We make restitution to children. We make restitution to our parents. We make restitution to our wives. We make restitution to our husbands. We make restitution to anybody that we have offended. If you have told lies, you set right your way. Whatever the consequence, don't worry about that. We want to get to heaven. That's why we're doing that. In Revelation chapter 21 verse 27. Revelation 21 verse 27. And there shall in no wise enter into it anything that defileth, neither whatsoever walketh abomination or maketh a lie, but they which are written in the Lamb's book of life. Now Revelation chapter 22 verse 16. I, Jesus, have sent mine angel to testify these things in the churches. I am the root and the offspring of David, the bright and the morning star. And the spirit and the bride say, come. And let him that heareth say, come. And let him that is athirst come. And whosoever will, let him take of the water of life freely. The Lord is telling us salvation is still available today. And whosoever will may come. Just come to the Lord and repent of your sin. And the Lord will forgive you. The invitation is still open. Come, come. Come, you can come and take the water of life freely. In Isaiah chapter 55, I'm reading from verse 1. Isaiah chapter 55, we're looking at it from verse 1. The invitation of the Lord that is still coming. Did you find that you are dirty, or you are defiled, or you are like a dog, or you are fighting, or you are a sorcerer, you're a witch, you're a wizard, or you're an idol worshiper? The Lord is saying, you can come to the cleansing fountain, and the blood of Jesus will wash you whiter than snow. Isaiah chapter 55, reading from verse 1. Oh, everyone that thirsteth, everyone that has said, come ye to the waters, and he that has no money, come ye, buy and eat. Come, ye, come, buy wine and milk without money and without price. Wherefore do you spend your money for that which is not bread, and your labor for that which satisfieth not? Hearken diligently unto me, and eat ye that which is good, and let your soul delight itself in fatness. Incline your ear, and come unto me. Hear, and your soul shall live, and I will make an everlasting covenant with you, even the sure mercies of David. Verse 6, seek ye the Lord while he may be found. Call ye upon him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake his way, and the unrighteous man his thoughts, and let him return unto the Lord, and he will have mercy upon him, and to our God, for he will abundantly pardon. The Lord is saying you can come for the water of life, and you can come freely. You just repent of your sin. You say, Lord, I'm through. I don't want to commit sin anymore. I don't want to do this evil thing anymore. I feel so much guilt and burden on me. I want a change. I want a transformation. I want to be a new creature in Christ. And the Lord will do it. In John chapter 4, verse 10, and then verse 14, Jesus answered and said unto her, if thou knewest the gift of God, and who is he that saith unto thee, give me to drink, thou wouldest have asked of him, and he would have given thee living water. That water of life, that's the living water, is coming from Christ. And that's our salvation, that is saying there, come and get it, come and receive it, and come and enjoy, experience the salvation of the Lord. In verse 14, but whosoever drinketh of the water that I shall give him shall never thirst, for the water, but the water that I shall give him shall be in him a well of water springing up into everlasting life. The Lord is calling you today, and you shouldn't reject the call of the Lord today. Still saying, come unto me. In Matthew chapter 11 verse 28, come unto me all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. You're laboring and you're struggling and striving to overcome sin. You won't make it by yourself. It takes the grace of God and the mercy of God. That's why it says, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me. You learn of the Lord. And when you learn of the Lord, your character will change, your behavior will change. Take my yoke upon you. Learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and you shall find rest unto your souls. For my yoke is easy, and my burden is light. If you come, he'll not push you away. He'll not reject you. He'll not cast you off. He'll give you that salvation. In John chapter 6, verse 37. John chapter 6, verse 37. It says, and all that the Father giveth me shall come to me, and him that cometh to me, I will in no wise cast out. If you come, he'll forgive you. He'll change your life. He'll turn everything around. He will write your name in the book of life. Then you'll be able to say, now I'm saved. I'm a child of God, and I know it. And if the trumpet shall sound any time, by the grace of God, keeping me in holiness and righteousness for the rest of my life, I know I will be, and I will be with the Lord forever. We come to point number three, the preservation of the complete scriptural canon. The preservation of the complete scriptural canon. We're told in chapter 22, Revelation chapter 22, reading from verse 18 and verse 19. For I testify unto every man that heareth the words of the prophecy of this book. Every man that heareth the words of the prophecy of this book. Every man that heareth of the words of the prophecy of this book. As we look at your outline, we're on lesson, we're on the study 52. I've been coming from chapter 1, and you have been hearing. What have you done with what you have heard? And when you got back home, as you had the seriousness of the word of God, what did you discuss with your wife and your husband at home? When you heard the word of repentance, because as you have studied this, as we came from chapter 1 through to this chapter 52, we have covered every doctrine of the Bible, every doctrine of the word of God, because you know that while we're in Revelation, we go back to Genesis, we come to Exodus, we go to Joshua, we come to the Psalms, and we come to the Proverbs. Even today alone, think about the books of the Bible that we have covered. Already today, we've read in so many parts of the Bible, Old Testament, New Testament. And as we have studied all these 52 studies, how many books of the Bible have we referred to? How many doctrines have we referred to? And how much of our lifestyle have we referred to? And when you got back home, talking to your friend, talking to your husband, talking to your wife, how did you discuss the word of God? Any man, I testify unto you, every man that heareth the words of the prophecy of this book, if any man shall add unto these things, God shall add unto him the plagues that are written therein. If after hearing the word of God, you come to the study, or you come to the Sunday worship, or you come to the revival and we read the word of God plain, simple, and clear, applicable to you. And because the thing convicted you, and because there was something to correct, and because there was something to turn away from, and because there's something to extract out of your life, changing your life, transforming your life, then you got back home, you began to twist what you heard. For I testify unto every man that heareth the words of the prophecy of this book, if any man shall add unto these things, God shall add unto him the plagues that are written therein in this book. In verse 19, and if any man shall take away from the words of the book of this prophecy, if any man shall take away, maybe you are here, look up here. You are here when we're studying Matthew. And then maybe you're not gone. You're no more here. Maybe you are here when we're studying Colossians, or studying James, or studying Jude. You are here when we're studying the Philippians. You are here when we're studying in Daniel. Or you are here when we studied in the Psalms. You were here when we studied in the parables of Jesus Christ. And then after some time, you felt, well, I don't want to stay in this local assembly anymore. And then you have gone away. Since you left, if you have left, and since those people, your friends, since they have left, what are they preaching now? Are they taking away from the word of God? Sanctification that Jesus Christ himself mentioned. Holiness that Jesus Christ himself taught. Purity of heart that Jesus Christ himself taught. And that he now came to the church through John, the beloved. And he says, go and tell them that blessed are those saints who are preparing themselves, and they clothe themselves in the purity of the saints, the robe of righteousness. Now you're taking that away. And if anybody challenges you, I'm not in deeper life anymore. And so what? You are not in deeper life. Are you not in the Bible? And didn't you read Revelation chapter 22 verse 19? If any man shall take away from the words of the book of this prophecy. And then there are people that they have changed on marriage. They have changed on many, many doctrines of the Bible. They believed it before. If you challenge them now, why are you not preaching this anymore? You know, when we're in deeper life, if you make a mistake and you preach anything different, you know you are going to be deceiving. But now I'm by myself. I am the bishop here now. I am the overseer here now. I can do anything I want. I can preach anything I want. I can omit anything I don't want to preach. No, you cannot. That you are not in deeper life does not mean that you will tamper with the word of God. If any man shall take away from the words of the book of this prophecy, God shall take away his part out of the book of life. How serious that is. How serious that is. And you know that there are sometimes that, you know, somebody tells you, and he says, every time I go to church, I feel unhappy. I feel unhappy because, you know, there's a little problem in my life, and they're always knocking at that problem. And then you advise that person, you say, okay, if you're feeling inconvenient, just to make yourself feel at ease, why don't you go to the church over there? Why don't you go to the church over there? Maybe they will not be mentioning things that will convict you anymore. And then even though you yourself, you're still in deeper life, you encourage another person to go to a place where they will be taken away from the word of God, and there will be no conviction anymore. When judgment comes upon those people, judgment will come upon you too. If any man shall take away from the words of the book of this prophecy, God shall take away his part out of the book of life, out of the holy city. The Lord will not allow your foot to step on the holy city. And from the things that are written in this book, the Lord is telling us, don't take anything away and don't add anything to the word of God. Deuteronomy chapter 4 verse 2. Deuteronomy chapter 4 verse 2. Here he's telling us, you don't add, you don't subtract, you don't add, you don't diminish. In Deuteronomy chapter 4 verse 2. Ye shall not add unto the word which I command you, neither shall thou diminish aught from it, that ye may keep the commandments of the Lord your God, which I command you. You will not subtract, you will not add any little thing to the word of God. The doctrines of the word of God as we're given, we just keep everything like that, and then ask for the grace of God to help us so we can be doers of the word. Deuteronomy chapter 12 verse 32. What things soever I command, observe to do it. Thou shalt not add thereto, nor diminish from it. You see what the Lord is telling us? He's telling us, just, are you going to be wiser than God? Are you going to be more knowledgeable than God? Are you going to correct the word of God? Are you going to tell the Almighty God, Almighty God, you made a mistake. I'm wiser than you are. Let me correct you. Man cannot be holy. Man cannot be sanctified. The world is too dirty and the world is too difficult and Satan is too terrible. You should know Satan, Almighty God. Satan will not allow us to be sanctified. There's no sanctification. Are you going to correct God? Are you going to correct the word of God? Are you going to be wiser than the Almighty? Are you going to be wiser than a creator? How can you correct God? As the Lord has given us the word, we receive the word and we retain the word. In Jeremiah chapter 26 verse 2. Jeremiah chapter 26 verse 2. Thus says the Lord, stand in the court of the Lord's house and speak unto all the cities of Judah which come to worship in the Lord's house. All the words that I command thee to speak unto them, diminish not a word. Diminish not a word. Actually, that's what ran Jeremiah into trouble. Because when Jeremiah preached to the people, they said, what kind of a word are you preaching? This is too hard. Take it away. Subtract it. Dilute it. Lower it. Make it simpler. And then they said, if you don't, we'll deal with you. You know, there are people that will threaten you. You know, sometimes maybe if you preach, maybe we'll give you a chance to preach in the retreat. And we gave you a topic that you have to be faithful. And then after finishing the preaching, and then we're going to the cafeteria, we leaders. And then one of your friends will, you know, just get near and pinch you. Huh. Great preacher. What kind of thing is it you are talking to that time? You are a coordinator. When you want to preach, are you making that kind of illustration and then pointing at us? You may be a coordinator there, and you may be, are you general superintendent? Are you pastor? You are a coordinator, and then you have the audacity and the boldness of making illustration concerning us. If you do that again, you know, we the rest people will deal with you. You are shutting up his mouth, and you are saying, don't preach like that again. What right do you have to tell a preacher, even if he's junior to you in the church, in the ministry, to tell him, how can you preach like that? That's what they did to Jeremiah. The Lord told Jeremiah, said, this is what the Lord has said, and I'm not going to take out a single word out of what the Lord had said. So they said, okay, we're going to deal with you. Look at verse 12. And then spake Jeremiah to all the princes and all the people, saying, the Lord sent me to prophesy against this house and against this city all the words that ye have heard. Now, therefore, amend your ways and your doings, and obey the voice of the Lord your God, and the Lord will repent from him of the evil that he has pronounced against you. As for me, behold, I'm in your hand. Do with me as it seemeth good and meet unto you. I preach the word of God. I've given you what the Lord has given me. I didn't add, I didn't take away. Anything you want to do to me, please go ahead and do. As for me, behold, I'm in your hand. Do with me as it seemeth me good and meet you. But know ye for certain that if ye put me to death, ye shall surely bring innocent blood upon yourselves and upon this city and upon the inhabitants thereof. For of a truth, the Lord has sent me unto you to speak all these words in your ears. I've been faithful to God. Therefore, if you hurt me and do anything to me, know of it true that I was only being faithful to God. You see, that's what Jeremiah did. You'll not be afraid of people that you cannot tell the truth and what the Lord has given you to preach. In Proverbs chapter 30, verses 5 and 6. Proverbs chapter 30. We're looking at verses 5 and 6. Here the word of God tells us, once again, every word of God is pure. He is a shield unto them that put their trust in him. Add thou not unto his words, lest he reprove thee and thou be found a liar. Don't add, don't subtract. Matthew chapter 28, verse 20. In Matthew chapter 28, we're looking at verse 20. Here the Lord Jesus said, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you, and lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. In Galatians chapter 1, verses 8 and 9. Galatians chapter 1, reading verses 8 and 9. Here the Lord is telling us once again through Paul the apostle, but though we or an angel from heaven, we or an angel from heaven preach any other gospel unto you than that which we have preached unto you, let him be accursed. When it says we, means we apostles, we who taught you the truth before. If we came back and we told you, well, nobody can live above sin anymore. Nobody can be sanctified anymore. There's no power of the Holy Ghost anymore. And nobody can be healed anymore. And now, you know, everything that we have been saying before, those things are not true anymore. Do we or an angel from heaven preach any other gospel unto you than that which were preached unto you? Let him be accursed. As we said before, so say I now again, if any man preach any other gospel unto you than that ye have received, let him be accursed. The curse of God remains upon the people that are twisting the word of God, that are not standing on the word of God. Do you see what the Lord said here? If any man shall take away from the words of the book of this prophecy, God shall take away his part out of the book of life. In Exodus chapter 32, Exodus chapter 32, we're looking at verse 33. Exodus 32, looking at verse 33. And the Lord said unto Moses, whosoever have sinned against me, him will I blot out of my book. And you know, there are people that say, once you are saved, you are forever saved. You may take away from the word of God, you are forever saved. You may add to the word of God, you are forever saved. You may go into false doctrine, you are forever saved. You may go into occultism while you are trying to look for healing. You have established a new ministry and you want people to be getting healed. And you want multitudes to come. And then you go and kill maybe animal and then you bury it there. And they say as many worms, as many whatever maggots are coming up there, all the people will be coming. And then you are sacrificing already, going into occultism because you want your new ministry and new church to grow. You've gone away from the word of God in looking for success and looking for miracle. And the Lord said unto Moses, whosoever have sinned against me, him will I blot out of my book. We are not going to allow God to blot out our name. We'll remain in the Lord. Because the Lord is coming very soon. And I've made up my mind, I'm going to be ready. Come what may, whatever may happen, whatever may not happen, I'll be ready. How about you? I said how about you? You want to be ready. If you want to be ready, that's why you want to remain with the grace of God, in the strength of the Lord, that you not allow anything at all to ever send you back. The Lord is assuring us his sin is coming quickly. In Revelation chapter 22 verse 20, it says, he will testify these things, says, surely let there be no doubt in your heart. Almighty God says surely, Jesus says surely, the Holy Ghost says surely, the angel says surely, and the apostle says surely, surely I come quickly. Amen. Even so, come Lord Jesus. If there's no sin in your life, you'll be happy to say come Lord Jesus. If you are saved and sanctified, you'll be able to say come Lord Jesus. If there is no guilt, there is no condemnation. If there's no restitution not yet made, you'll be able to say come Lord Jesus. If you are not fighting with your wife at home, not fighting with your husband at home, you'll be able to say even so, come Lord Jesus. If you have not stolen church money that you have not confessed, you'll be able to happily say come Lord Jesus. If you are not living in adultery, secret adultery, fornication, you'll be able to happily say come Lord Jesus. And if you are not tampering with those girls and ladies in your yard, in your house, you'll be able to say even so, come Lord Jesus. If you are not in any secret plot, any secret plan with the people that are backsliding, you'll be able to say even so, come Lord Jesus. If your heart is clear, if your heart is clean, if your life is transparent, if you say come and see my heart, if I can open my heart to you, everything is cleansed, everything is pure, everything is holy, I believe the Lord has planted my feet in that holiness without which no man shall see the Lord, you'll be able to say even so, come Lord Jesus. And then the Lord says, while you are getting ready, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the goodness of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the riches of redemption and the abundance of the Lord, and the complete promises of God, the exceeding abundant promises of God, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Grace for salvation and grace for sanctification and grace for service and grace, abundant grace, sufficient grace, and the grace that is sufficient for every need of your life, that grace available today. If you will come to the Lord, you need salvation, grace be unto you. And you need sanctification, grace be unto you. And you need Holy Ghost power, grace be unto you. You need strength and fortification, energy of the Holy Ghost to be able to stand firm until the very end. Grace is available today. It is still the day of grace. Let's go therefore before the Lord, seeking the grace of God. It will help us. I said it will help us. If with all your heart, without any pretense, you just open your heart before the Lord, then you pray to the Lord, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ will be with you. Let's rise up and talk to the Lord. This is the grace we need. We need this grace. We need this grace. We need this grace so that we'll live the life He wants us to live. We'll be prepared for the coming of the Lord. We take the word of God serious with all our heart, with all our soul, with all our mind. We're telling the Lord, oh Lord, here I am. Oh Lord, here I am. I need your grace. I need your grace. I want to stand. I don't want to be falling and rising, rising and falling. I want to stand. Stand in righteousness and stand in holiness and stand in love and stand in purity. I want to be standing when you come. I want to be praying when you come. I want to be serious when you come. I want to be winning souls when you come. I want to be serving you when you come. I need your grace today. Lord, help me. The Lord will help you. Open your mouth, open your heart, open your mind, open everything unto the Lord and say, Lord, here am I. Don't hide anything. Don't hide anything. You are backsliding, don't hide it. If you will confess your backsliding to the Lord, He will forgive you. You have been living a life of lying, a life of deception, a life of hypocrisy, a life of insincerity. If you open to the Lord, He will forgive you. He will cleanse you, and then He will make you ready. Then you'll be able to say with all confidence and with all joy and with all expectation and hope, even so, come, Lord Jesus. Are you afraid because of restitution? Make your restitution. Then you'll be happy to say, even so, come, Lord Jesus. Is there any debt in your heart? Pornography. All the literature on pornography that will defile you. Why don't you throw them away? Burn them up. Then you'll be able to say, even so, come, Lord Jesus. All those perforated dresses, all the jewelry and all the cosmetics and all those things relates to worldliness. If you cleanse your life from them, then you'll be happy to say, even so, come, Lord Jesus. If you've been living immorally with another man's wife, another woman's husband, and then today you separate, you cut it off, and you are cleansing the blood of the Lamb, and you come out clean, completely clean, then you'll be able to say, even so, come, Lord Jesus. If you know that your heart is purified, your heart is purged, and you are purified and sanctified, and you are made holy, and the Lord Himself purifies you and cleanses you and cuts off all those things that are not right in your life, and now your life is white as snow, and your heart is pure as it ought to be. You are purified by the blood of the Lamb. You are cleansed by the blood of the Lamb. Then you'll be able to say, even so, come, Lord Jesus. If you're in courtship and you are not messing up yourself, or you have gotten married and you are not going to mates or going to other people, and you are standing on the word of God, a pure life, a righteous life, a holy life, a transparent life, then you'll be able to say, even so, come, Lord Jesus. If you're evangelizing and your life is filled with the service of the Lord, and you're not pulling away from the service of the Lord, and you know you are not going to be ashamed when the Lord will come, you're doing your best, you're doing all you can do, you're serving the Lord in all sincerity, you'll be able to say, even so, come, Lord Jesus. If there's no skeleton in your cupboard, and if you're not hiding anything, your heart is clean, your heart is clear. Your life is clean, your life is clear. And everything is presented before the Lord. You'll be able to say, even so, come, Lord Jesus. If you're not adding to the word of God that has been given to you, you are faithfully preaching the word, even as you have received it, you'll be able to say, even so, come, Lord Jesus. If you're not subtracting from the word of God, if you're sincere, if you're honest, if you're yielded to the Lord, if you're submissive to the Lord, you'll be able to say, even so, come, Lord Jesus. If you know that the Lord looks at your life now and is pleased with your life, is pleased with your language, is pleased with your interaction, is pleased with everything that you are doing, you're not doing anything in secret, that I hope the church will not know this, I hope the church will not hear this, I hope my leaders will not hear this, I hope the pastor will never hear this one, I hope the pastor will never see this, if there's nothing you're hiding, if there's nothing you're doing anywhere, you're hoping nobody will see, then you'll be able to say, even so, come, Lord Jesus. Are you born again? Are you a child of God? Are you still standing in the grace of the Almighty God? Or are you backsliding and hiding it? Are you falling and hiding it? Are you then, are you just managing the Christian life? You are managing your guilt and managing your condemnation, and you are managing the oppression upon your life, and you are managing just the condemnation you are having. Are you telling the Lord, oh Lord, I believe you. Oh Lord, I believe you. Oh Lord, I accept you. I accept everything you are telling me. Then you'll be able to say, come, Lord Jesus. You will not be a person that is just saying, I hope he will not come now. I hope he will not come now. I hope I will still have chance. I hope this and that. You are not dealing with anything that is evil, private or public, anywhere you are. Then you'll be able to say, even so, come, Lord Jesus. Open your heart before the Lord. That's why we came here. That's why we came here, so that you can really pray. Just preaching it is not enough. Just hearing it is not enough. Just sharing it is not enough. Just leading other people is not enough. Being a leader will not take you to heaven. It's being holy. Being a preacher will not take you to heaven. It's being holy. Being a worker will not take you to heaven. It's being holy. Follow peace with all men and holiness, without which no man shall see the Lord. He that has this hope in him purifieth himself. Purifieth himself. Purifieth himself. Even as he is pure, the Lord is calling upon you. When are you going to get ready? When are you going to be prepared for the coming of the Lord? And the Lord wants you to take the word of the Lord serious, with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and say, Lord, here am I, here am I. My heart is open. My life is transparent. I want to be a real child of God. No skeleton in my cupboard. Nothing I'm covering up. Just following the Lord. Just living my life the way you want me to live. Purge me more, Lord. Purify me more, Lord. Cleanse me more, Lord. Let the blood of the Lamb so purge and purify me. Help me, Lord, to be the kind of person I ought to be. A new creature in Christ. A new creature in Christ. A new creature in Christ. A new heart. A new spirit. A new life. A new mind. A new disposition. A new character. That's what I want to be, Lord. I want to have the righteousness of the saints. I want to be covered with the robe of righteousness. And my language to be pure. My attitude to be pure. My heart to be pure. My character to be pure. Everything within me, everything around me, I want to live a pure life, a holy life, a righteous life, a sanctified life. I don't know when the Lord will come, in the morning, afternoon, or in the evening, or in the night. I want to be ready. I don't want to sleep over everything that is guilt or condemnation. I want to make sure that every moment of the day and every day of my life, I know that I'm checking up every time. I'm ready. I'm ready. I'm living by faith. I'm living in the grace of God. I'm living in the word of God. I'm living in faithfulness to the Lord. Everything he has taught me that I know. I'm living in the light of the gospel I've received. You tell the Lord. Tell the Lord. So you can be ready when he comes. Be ready when he comes. Be ready when he comes. It's coming again. It's coming again. Behold, I come quickly, and my reward is with me to give unto everyone as his work shall be. I come quickly. I come quickly. He that testified this thing says, behold, I come quickly. Even so, Lord Jesus, come. Even so, Lord Jesus, come. You tell the Lord, yes, I'm coming. Yes, I'm coming into the fullness of the grace of the Lord, into the cleansing of the Lord, into the purity of the Lord, into the holiness that will provide. You are going to be holy. You are going to be pure. Blessed are the pure in heart. Blessed are the pure in heart. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see the Lord. Only the pure in heart. Only the holy. Those who are following peace with all men. Following peace with all men. You're not living a life of strife, a life of conflict, a life of fighting, a life of disagreement, a life of bitterness, a life of tearing apart. Blessed are those people, if you're at peace with all men, and then you follow holiness, without which no man shall see the Lord. The Lord is calling you. The Lord is calling you, and the Lord is saying, pray. You make sure that you pray and you hand over, you give yourself completely unto the Lord, so that you will be ready when he comes. You'll be ready when he comes. If you are not saved, would you be ready? If you are not sanctified, would you be ready? If there are things you have not said to in your life, would you be ready? And if you're still fighting with people and having bitterness, strife in your heart, will you be ready? If you are hypocritical, will you be ready? If you are sinning privately, will you be ready? If you are lying to your wife and lying to your husband and lying to your children and lying to your parents, will you be ready? If you have not corrected all those things, will you be ready? If you are a thief and you have not made restitution, will you be ready? And if you are doing evil in the private and then you are claiming to be a child of God, will you be ready? Be ready when it will come. Be ready when it will come. Be ready when it will come. You talk to the Lord in prayer. You say, Lord, I want to be ready. Lord, I want to be ready. Lord, I want to be ready. I'm giving myself to you. The Lord wants to do it right now. He wants to do it right now. And then you make a covenant with the Lord. Lord, you purify me now. You purge my life now. You make me holy now. I will not go back anymore. I will not go back anymore. I don't know when Christ will come. He may come tonight. He may come tomorrow. He may come next week. I want to be ready when the Lord will come. I don't want any sin, a way to tie me down, or besetting sin to tie me down, any hypocrisy to tie me down, any insincerity to tie me down, any iniquity to tie me down, any worldliness to tie me down, any friendship with anybody, agreement with anybody to tie me down, any plot, any conspiracy with anybody to tie me down. I want to be ready when the Lord will come. I want to be ready when the Lord will come. The Lord is telling you, He wants you to be ready. Then check your life. Examine yourself. Are you ready? Are you preparing for the Lord? Are you having the grace of God in your life, the grace that bringeth salvation that appears unto all men, teaching us to deny ungodliness and worldly lusts and to live soberly, righteously, justly, unblameably in this present world? Are you living that kind of life? That kind of life. Are you pure in your heart? Are you pure in your soul? Are you pure in your spirit? Are you pure through and through, morning and evening and night, every time at home and outside? Are you pure through and through? That's what the Lord is expecting, and those are the people will be coming for. You tell the Lord, yes, Lord, I want to be ready. Yes, Lord, I want to be ready. I want you to purify me and cleanse me and keep me holy and keep me clean, so that when you come, I will be ready. I want to be ready. That's why I'm coming. That's why I'm here. That's why I'm in church. That's why I'm coming to worship here. I didn't come here to play. I came here to worship the Lord and be ready when the Lord shall come. And be ready when the Lord shall come. Oh Lord, make me ready. He will do it. Yes, make me ready. He will do it if you will allow Him. He will do it if you will allow Him. He wants to do it. He wants to do it. This is the day of grace. And this is the day of His preparation, preparing for the coming of the Lord. He will help you. He'll help you to overcome every temptation. He'll help you to overcome in every storm of life and in every evil thing that may come to challenge you. He'll make you ready. If you will just say, yes, Lord, I give myself to you. I surrender myself to you. He'll make you ready. Make sure you pray and you are settled and you are settled and you know if the Lord shall come.